Welcome to Inside OPSU. I'm Consuelo, the Director of Continuing Education at OPSU's Guymon Classroom. We're here for the 17th Annual Paul Farrell Memorial Art Auction. We'll be interviewing students, alumni, instructors, all artists of different walks of life. Our first student is Rebecca Warner. Rebecca, tell us a little bit about yourself. Where are you from?
I'm from Elkhart, Kansas.
Okay, and you've been here at Panhandle for how long?
3 years.
Okay, is this your first show?
No, this would be my third one.
It is?
Yep, I've been here all 3 years.
So why did you choose to go to Panhandle State?
I chose OPSU for the friendliness of the staff. All my teachers have been incredibly helpful, and I mean, I can't think of a better art department with putting on a whole show for us. So
did you come to Panhandle because of the art program?
Yes. I had considered going to a different college, and then my teacher in high school invited me to this auction as a senior in high school.
Mm-hmm.
And this is definitely what changed my mind.
Really?
So, mm-hmm.
Okay. What are your plans after graduation?
Well, definitely want to become a teacher, probably over in Kansas, but not picky on the grade, but definitely want to be an art teacher. So
I would be so picky on the grade. Okay, so you've got four pieces that are in the auction this year. So let us go ahead and start with this first piece. Tell us what it is and tell us a little bit about it.
This one's an oil on canvas. It's an Overo mare, a type of paint horse. This was when I was trying to get away from my realism and experiment with colors. So I chose a vivid color palette and then the drippy background to blur it out but still add interest to it.
Okay. And what's the name of this one?
This one's called Overo Mare.
Okay. And then let's go ahead and move to this one.
This one is Spring. It's a watercolor. I used a lot of the salt technique, again with my bright colors.
Well, for the viewers who don't understand some of the techniques you just mentioned, salt technique, so explain that just a little bit, just briefly, so that way they understand, because you can see.
So when you need to create this technique, you're going to wet down your paper, let your color spill like I did,
mm-hmm.
and then when it gets to a satin sheen, not really wet, but not to the point of dry, you sprinkle salt over it,
mm-hmm.
wait a few minutes, and the salt sucks up the paint. And that's how you get that look.
That's how you get the little dippled
effect.
The little
dots, kind of, yeah.
Okay. And what's the name of this one?
Spring. This one is Horse Feathers. Again, this is the same technique that I used with the cow. Horses are my favorite animals, always have been. And I love to get into the Native American tradition of war horses. So that would be the reason behind the paint.
Okay, so explain to me the colors.
Well,
why did you choose the colors that you've chosen?
One of our projects was actually to look into what other artists done, so like famous artists or artists that we've seen in the news, and so I chose Chance Hayes,
mm-hmm.
and he does a lot of colors, and I liked that, but I wanted to keep from making them muddy and too cluttered, so I used a lot of the white space and brown in it. And then colors to complement each other, like blue and red are close to opposites.
Right.
So.
Okay, very good. All right, so then tell us about the last one.
I wanted to do something a little different besides cows and horses, so I chose a bison.
So is this your, is it from a photo that you've taken, or?
I've used three different reference photos that I had found. The original one that is closest to the way his face is tilted was him scratching his face against a pole. So I took the pole out. I didn't think that would look good. I love the drippy style that I do with my watercolors, and it's a little harder to do with oil because it's so thick, but I managed to thin my paint down and still keep the vivid turquoises and oranges.
So these are with brush strokes, correct?
Yes. It's oil that is thinned down with mineral spirits and just reapplied over and over till it gets dark enough to drip down and you can tell.
Okay. Very good.
So.
Okay. Is there anything that you would like our viewers to know about your artwork? You're wanting to be a teacher after you graduate from college. Are you wanting to, are you going to be in any galleries? Do you have anything in any galleries currently?
I don't have anything in galleries currently yet. I've been told that a few galleries might contact me, and I'd be really excited for that. That's not the path had expected, yeah. But I really want to be a teacher because art was like an escape for me through things that had been going on, and a good way to let yourself loose, basically, escape from the world.
Well, our viewers, a lot of them, may be here this evening. They may be bidding on your art. If by chance they miss out on any of these pieces, is there a way that they can contact you and talk to you about maybe having a piece done for them?
Yes, I do commission work. I've got a Facebook page, Rebecca Warner Traditional Artist. So they can contact me through that.
Okay.
And so, yeah.
Very good. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
With us now, Sage Kinsey. Sage, tell our viewers a little bit about yourself. Where are you from?
I'm from Dairzet, Texas, originally. I graduated from Allen Cleo over by Enid, Oklahoma. But I started college at OPSU in the fall of 2012.
Okay. Why did you select OPSU?
Okay. I get that
question
a lot.
There's always a story. Yeah. No, there's always a story.
Both of my parents actually graduated from OPSU, and that was kind of a school that was in my radar, but I wasn't sure if I wanted to go there or not, but I heard lots of people talking about the great art department, and I knew I loved art. I didn't take very many art classes in high school, but it was just something I loved, and so I was like, okay, I'm going to go to OPSU, try this out, and we'll see.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, so what were you coming here specifically for art?
Yes. Yeah, I just wanted to have an art degree and see where that took me.
But you didn't really do much art in high school.
No, I actually only had one art class, and it was over ITV. So if you can imagine ITV art, not the best way to learn art.
That would be terrible,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, it was awful, like holding up your picture, you know, trying to show the the teacher on the other side. Yeah, it was not good.
Well, okay. So, well, I think you have definitely learned a lot over here at Panhandle State. So you've got four pieces.
Mm-hmm.
Pick which one you want to start. Well, let's just start on the end. Sorry,
okay.
I know I just kind of backed you into a corner.
No, that's okay. I was kind of in the corner back here.
Well, tell us about the piece. Tell us about the medium that you used and why you selected this particular picture.
Okay, well, my reference for this picture came from my great-grandpa's auction he had. He had several old cars he was auctioning off. And instead of doing the typical full car shot painting, I decided to focus more on the emblem, and I threw a couple flowers up there and really liked how the colors kind of bounced along with the rust colors of the truck.
Uh-huh.
So I thought it made a good photo. Why not try to replicate it in a painting? And this one is a watercolor painting. Watercolor wasn't really one of my favorites when I started here, but it's started to grow on me, so I'm definitely producing more watercolors.
No, I really like the watercolor. Okay, tell us about this piece here then.
Okay, this one, these guys were actually in the Pioneer's Day Parade in Guymon.
Mm-hmm.
And I took a picture of them walking down Main Street. And I figured, why not put them in a more natural setting? So
rather than downtown
Guymon?
Yeah,
with McDonald's in the background, you know, not the typical Longhorn setting. But threw in some clouds. It's an oil painting, and I had never messed with oil before I got to college, so this was kind of a new experience for me. But I really like the smooth texture you can get with oil. It blends easily It's a little rough for details, and I'm a details person, so you have to work a little harder at that. But
versus watercolor?
Yeah, watercolor you can get really fine with your brushes. Oil, it's really hard because it smears, so like for the eyes and stuff, you have to be really careful or wait and let it dry a little bit so you can get really good details. But
okay, all right, next one.
Okay.
Another car,
except Chevy versus Ford here. This one, I took the reference at the Hooker Car Show, another local event, and I really liked the reflections. I could see the clouds and the trees in the background, and this one is oil as well. And I'm glad I chose to do this one in oil because, like I mentioned in this one, the smoothness you can get with oil, and it just blends so nice and easily. I don't think you would be able to really achieve that in any other medium, so.
Okay, very good. You got sharp lines in this one.
Yeah, and it's really tough to get those sharp lines, but I'm a details person, so super hard.
All right, so moving on to this one. Very colorful.
Yes.
A little different from the cars and the cows.
Yes, actually this is more my style, I think most people would say. I came to college as a bright color loving person, always wearing bright colors, and hot pink is one of my favorite colors. This is also an oil painting, and I enhanced the colors in this one obviously a little bit, but I had fun with this one and I really, really liked how it turned out.
Tell us about the different things that you're learning in class, because you have watercolor, you have oil. Part of the things that you're learning over at Panhandle State, it's not just about putting the paint on the canvas. Did you take framing classes as well? I mean, are you the one that helped with these frames or did these frames?
Well, when it comes to like painting classes, Brian teaches us a variety of techniques. So we just take those techniques and run with them and apply them like however they may fit in our style.
Mm-hmm.
As for the frames, I'm a perfectionist, so it's really tough for me to frame pieces that are going in shows. So most of the time I send them off to have them framed.
Okay.
Just in case, you know, because I don't want to put more effort into it and it turn out not so great. But we do learn framing over there as well. So I do know how to do it. You just
didn't do it this time.
Yes, just didn't do it this
nope,
time.
That's okay. Approximately how long did it take you to do, pick any of the pieces? How long does it take you whenever you say, okay, I think I'm going to do flowers? From there, how long does it take for you to finish this?
Well, in most art classes, we have around 2 weeks or so for a project. And so I would say that's pretty close to how long it takes me to finish most of these, I would say. Yeah, good 2 weeks.
So, and just pick this last, well, let's say the fall of 16. How many pieces did you produce in that semester? Because if you're a perfectionist, you probably have a ton of art at your house that you're like, oh no, I'm not gonna show anybody.
Oh yeah, I would say probably a good four or five pieces per class for a semester. So if you're taking like 3 art classes, you know, a good 15 pieces finished. Yeah, and sitting around the house waiting to be sold, so.
Okay. So for viewers that aren't able to be here at the auction, how do they go about getting in touch with you if they would like for you to commission a piece for them?
The best way to reach me is probably through my email, which is sage.kinsey@gmail.com.
Okay, spell it out just in case. Sage, S-A-G-E.
S-A-G-E dot Kinsey, K-I-N-S-E-Y, @gmail.com.
Perfect. All right, well, good luck in the auction tonight.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
With us now, Tanya Cleaver. Tanya, tell our viewers a little bit about yourself. Where are you from?
I'm from Aurora, Nebraska.
What?
Yes.
How did you get here from Aurora?
Well, that's a funny story. I originally came down here as an ag major, and I actually graduated last May with 2 ag degrees in equine science and animal nutrition. And now I'm currently a computer graphics major with an emphasis in art.
So, what the heck?
Well, I came down here for the ag degree and then also the equestrian team originally, and I did that for about 3 years and got done with my other two degrees and decided that
You're
I
like,
wanted to...
I'm not ready to be done with school.
I know,
love
I just want to make a career out of going to school, apparently. So I decided that I've always loved doing drawings and art stuff, so I just decided that why not? I'll, and I kind of like the graphic design type of thing, so I just put art into it.
Okay, so after you graduate with your ag degree, seriously, is it just like, oh, I think I'm going to draw now. Well, I'm done with this. Or is this something that you've done?
It's kind of like, something I've done, but never like took a class necessarily. Like I took some Photoshop and stuff in high school, but never anything serious. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I've always kind of doodled and stuff like that, but never drawn seriously. So I just kind of decided to take a few classes and see how it went. And I really enjoyed it. And the things that they taught me, like Yvonne really taught me a lot in pastel and stuff like that. And mm-hmm. I really enjoyed it. So I just kind of was like, sure, I'll just continue on doing it. So,
well, not everybody is able to pick up a pencil and do something like this.
Yes.
So what is your background? Do you have anybody else in your family? I mean,
my father can draw. He never does, but I've gotten him to do it a few times, and what he comes up with is amazing. Like, he can just whip out a horse in like 5 seconds, and I don't know how he does it, but so I like to say I get it from him. I don't know where it comes from, but I just have always kind of been had the knack for drawing, and I like to say it came from him, but I don't really know.
All right, so how long did it take you to get from signing up for the class, going, we'll see how this goes, to this point here? Because this is a very nice picture.
This actually was in my, first drawing class that I took, actually. I did a few pieces before this. This is probably like my fourth piece, I think, maybe, of just colored pencil. But yeah, I just start going and I get so into it, I can't stop, and that happens.
So this also draws on your equine science degree as
Yeah,
well.
I've always loved horses. I've been riding since I was little, and so I just think they're beautiful animals and I enjoy drawing them. So I just really like putting that on paper and showing what I see. So,
what was the most challenging aspect of this piece? Because you have a lot of detail in that.
Yes, I think the eyes was the hardest on this one, just because it was a weird angle. Like, I combined some pictures. Like, I saw the angle of the horse in one picture, and I was like, oh, I like that. And then the mane came out of something else that I saw, and then the bridle and stuff was just me. But the eye was really hard because there wasn't a lot of light in the angle that it was at, so it was really hard to get the specific lighting to make it look like an actual eye. So I'd say the eye was the hardest, and then the mane itself, getting the texture into it. It was just, it hadn't something that I'd worked on a lot, so it was really hard to get that. That was probably the toughest for me.
Well, this one is very good. What is this one called?
Showtime.
Okay. And is this your horse?
No, it's just something I kind of combined off of, like, a random picture I saw.
A few of them?
Yeah, just a few different ones.
Okay, you've got a few other pieces here. Tell us about this one. What medium is this?
This is colored pencil on Canson paper.
On what paper?
Canson paper.
What is that?
I don't really know what it is either. Other than
just a type of paper.
It's just type of paper. It has a little texture on it, but not a lot. It's not my favorite paper. I prefer sandpaper, but I had it, so I used it.
Okay. So tell us about this piece then.
It's just an image that I came across on the internet. I'd never done any reflection pieces or water pieces, so I thought, why not try it? And I really liked the way that the light hit the water and reflected the light, so I thought that might be a challenge to try something new. I also did a previous piece that had some bricks in it, and I really liked the way the bricks came out. So I thought about doing that again, and that kind of came out. This is a darker setting than that one was, but I really wanted to try the bricks again. It took a lot of time to do the bricks, but I really like doing them. It's just, they're so colorful and you can do so much with them that I really enjoy.
They really are. They really are. And I think even the perspective, using the reflection because the lamp being upside down, or
yes,
the street post being upside down.
Yes, a lot of people question it and like, what are you drawing? Because it was upside down. They're like, why are you drawing an upside down lamp? And I was like, no, it's a reflection.
It's a reflection, guys. Come on.
Yes.
It's very nice. Very nice. Okay,
thank you.
So this piece, tell us about this one.
This is a pastel on sandpaper. I always love old things that look kind of abandoned, and I really enjoy doing them, the rustic type things. Mm-hmm. And this one just had a bunch of opportunity to do a bunch of colors, and just really, I hadn't ever done any landscape type stuff, like trees or anything in pastel, so this was my first attempt at that. And so I really enjoyed doing this one.
You did a very good job on those.
Thank you.
With the depth, you did very good on the.
Yes. So it was just kind of a play with things and the bricks, getting the texture of the bricks and laying them out on here was, it was a struggle, but like I got it done.
Okay, and I even like the color of the frame that you have with
yes,
this.
Yes, the frame, I spray painted the frame and then aged it, went back and aged it, and it really worked out well. I wasn't sure if it would work with it. I was a little afraid it wouldn't match, but it ended up perfect.
No, it's brilliant.
Yes, thank
it's
you.
Very good. Okay, again, I'm letting all of the artists let our viewers know how to get in touch with them. So if, because there's going to be people that are watching this that aren't able to be here this evening.
Yes.
So if you have anybody that would like to get in touch with you, or if you, do you commission pieces, or would you be interested in doing that?
I do commission some pieces.
Okay,
yes.
So if they would like to get in touch with you, how do they go about getting in touch with you?
The best way would probably be my email, which is Tanya,
You're going to have to spell it.
TKLIEWER@hotmail.com.
Okay, very good. All right, well, good luck in the auction this evening.
Thank you.
You've got very fine pieces.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Dustin Martinez. Dustin, tell our viewers a little bit about yourself.
Well, I was actually born in Mexico. Lived there till I was about 3 years old. Mom and I moved here to Guymon. This is where she graduated high school. And I've been here since I was 4 years old. Graduated Guymon High School in 2015 and am actually in my second semester of my sophomore year at Panhandle State. So kind of born and raised around here and stuck around the area. And I can say I love it. So.
All right, so why'd you choose Panhandle?
I chose Panhandle because both my parents came to school here back in the day. Don't tell them I said that, but and it was a good rodeo school, you know, being that I ride bulls and stuff, and I like it out here. I want to run cows one day along with, you know, doing my art and riding bulls professionally, hopefully, and this was just kind of a good place to do that, you know. Kinda,
so this is like a side gig?
Yes, ma'am. Just combined it all. And I actually, my inspiration started in high school. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Mr. Tess that teaches ceramics up at the high school. Mm-hmm. But I took ceramics my freshman year and kind of got inspired by him. And I just fell in love with it. And Panhandle actually started talking to me and wanting to recruit me the closer I got to graduate. And I was like, man, you kind of got to decide something, And down the bull riding just kind of pulled me in. And I'm glad. I'm really happy I chose to stay here. So anyways, I dang sure can't complain.
Did you ever participate in the Art Jubilee?
Yes, ma'am. I participated in the Art Jubilee. I think you can start participating your sophomore year, and I participated all years, so all 3 years that I could in high school.
Okay.
So,
did you ever place?
Yes, ma'am. I placed all 3 years. So, anyways, I don't know. I didn't really realize that OPSU had an art department and an art program like they did, you know. And then I knew all about rodeo, you know. It was just rodeo at Panhandle State. It's the saddle bronc capital of the world. And then I got there and realized that their art department was just extremely, extremely awesome. You know, everybody's there. It's just it's a homey feeling, you know, a small town like Goodwill. That's kind of all I've grown up around. So
yeah, every time I cut through that building, you're in there working on something.
Keep hitting my head on that. Yes, ma'am. But I spent a lot of hours up there. I've actually taken a break this semester from the ceramics, but I'm taking a metal sculpture class. So it's kind of a different change for me. You know, I mess with this ceramic stuff here, and then that's, you know, made out of the same material as this, but we don't fire that as hot. But that's considered sculpture, but it's out of the same ceramic material.
All right, so since you're already talking about the art, let's go ahead and start with this piece. Let's focus on this piece first of all.
Okay.
Okay, tell us what it's made out of and your inspiration.
This is made out of ceramic material from the earth. It's HBCA clay. And what we do with this is it's a long process when you attach it. And I actually had to flip it upside down because of the way the gravity works. When I tried to attach these corners, it just wanted to pull the sides.
Right.
So, you got to attach your sides and let it dry out before you can do the relief sculpture like I have here and stuff. So after we get that all worked out and stuff, you have to fire it one time. And we usually fire that at about 1,850 degrees, give or take a little bit.
Numbers are just so
high. Yeah, oh yeah. And it makes it really hard and durable stuff. And that's what we call our bisque fire. Well, okay. After it gets bisque fired, then you have to put what we call glaze on it. And that's where you get, this isn't the color that it looks like after the first firing. So after you apply the glaze on it, it actually, does different combinations. And what's really neat about it is you don't really know until you open the kiln because, firing temperatures, rates, there's so many different variables that can go into it. So it's kind of fun, but a little nerve-wracking at the same time. So whenever we glaze fire at the school, we normally fire up to cone 10, which is approximately 2,350 degrees, give or take a little bit. It just kind of depends. And how we tell is we have little gauges on the inside of our kiln that read us the temperature, but you can't fully trust those. So we have what are known as pyrometric cones, and you can you look inside the kiln. There's two peepholes or three, depends what kind of kiln you have. And you can pull those peepholes out and look into the peepholes, and you have different cones, and they tilt. And that tells you kind of how hot your kiln is or how hot your pottery is. Mm-hmm. So you look at your temperature reading from the kiln, the digital one, but you don't trust that 100%. So there's so many different variables that can go into this. It's just sometimes your pottery cracks, and especially in attached spots like this, it can bust open and stuff. So you never know until you get the kiln open and get it cooled down. So it's really fun. There's a lot of variables that can go into it.
Okay. So this one, this is where you like roll it out, right? And then you put it all together?
Yes, ma'am.
I don't know what that technique is called.
It's just called hand building.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. And what we do is this is all cut out slabs, put them through a slab roller after we make the clay. And how we make the clay is we get wet clay and mix it with dry clay in a clay mixer. And then we run it through a pug mill, which gets all the air out of it. And then it's ready to, be made into slabs or coils, whatever you need necessary for the job. So.
Okay.
And this and the canisters are all built the same technique, except the handles. These were made with a clay extruder.
So. Okay. So tell us about these pieces, because they're basically the same colors, aren't they?
Yes, ma'am. The colors I actually used, the glazes I used on both of these, is actually the sandy brown you see, or green, olive green, whatever you want to call it, is what's called magrutil. And the blue part that you see, the kind of a teardrop, color you would call it, teardrop sky blue. That is what you call boysenberry. And the difference in the two glazes is you can see this one runs a lot more than the magrutil appears to.
Right.
And they're different. There's different chemicals in it that causes it to do that. So you have to be really careful, because if I was to apply the same amount of the boysenberry as I did the magrutil all over the piece, it would run off the edges and stick to the kiln shelves, and the piece wouldn't be no good.
Really?
Yes, ma'am. So
wow.
It's just, there's all kinds of different variables. And one thing I did forget to mention, on this piece here, you see how that kind of has that rusty color to it, and this one's just the magrutil color. This, I applied what's called iron oxide.
Okay.
So, and I did that there, and then along the barbed wire stamps around the edge, which was just done with leather tools that a good friend of mine who does leather work gave me. So it's kind of cool. He's an artist, and I'm an artist, and we make it work.
Just share your tools?
Yep, it works out, so.
All right, tell us about this piece.
This piece was actually a piece I did over the summer. I was up at the school a lot this summer helping Brent. He was getting ready for a show that he had an eagle's nest. Eagle nest, is it eagle's nest or eagle nest? Either one. And I just was messing around. I really want to do sculpture one day, but I've kind of limited myself, I guess, not out of fear, just, like I said, there's so many variables, and the chances of that, something like that, because that's a different process of building than what these are. And there's just a lot of variables that can go into that as well. You can get air trapped inside of it, and when you fire it, that causes it to act like a bomb, because the chemical moisture inside that little bubble has to escape, so it finds places to pop out.
Right.
But this piece was built over the summer just kind of as a free mess around fun piece, and it the inspiration behind it was just, we don't have buffalo around here, but a buffalo is just a really basic, well-known animal, but it's really cherished because of just the history, tied to it and stuff. And this piece I just really had a good time with and messed around. It wasn't, it, in all honesty, it turned out better than I expected it to, if I can say that.
So is it solid?
No, it's actually hollow. It's hollow on the inside. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
It's hollow on the inside. And the inspiration I got behind, I don't know if your guys' camera can see from the angle it's at, but behind I have it to look like driftwood and other branches and trees growing within it. And the reason I did that is because, you know, the buffalo is kind of not an extinct animal, but there's the population of it's not as great as it used to be.
Right.
And, you know, they've died, and when people die or animals die, they go within the earth. And I kind of look at it as a way those buffaloes are kind of given back to the earth, and it's all intermingled, you know. They live with the grass and live with nature and all that, and they just kind of works hand in hand, so... It was just a fun project. I was really pleased with the way it turned out. And the coloring I did on that is actually not a glaze like these are. These are all food safe, dishwasher safe glazes. This is what's actually rub and buff. And the top of it is just a patina, just a blue patina overcoat.
Okay.
So, and how I do that is just rub circles with the toothbrush, squirt it on like toothpaste, and rub a ton of circles until it looks shiny. So...
Good, and you built the base as well?
Yes, ma'am. And the base is just got regular old, just barn wood kind of material. I don't know exactly what the kind of wood it is, but...
We'll call it rustic barn wood.
Rustic barn wood, yes. That's actually where I got it, just out of old barn scrap. And these right here are just the decorative thumb push tacks, and the cactus I use is actually what's called a choya cactus, and it's a native cactus here in Oklahoma, so...
All right,
just put that on there and... Just decorated up a little bit, so.
Very nice. You did very good.
Well, I appreciate it,
good
guys.
Luck in the auction tonight. But for our viewers, do you commission pieces?
Yes, I do commission pieces. And I also, I'm, you know, starting to venture on and do shows, take shows on myself and stuff. So if you ever go to a show in, say, Eagle Nest, or we have Pumpkin Patch in November here in Guymon every year, you guys keep an eye out for me. I plan on being there.
Very good. So how do they get in touch with you to go ahead and commission a piece?
You guys are welcome to call me or email me. My cell phone number is 580-651-3790, or you can email me at dustin.martinez15@yahoo.com, all lowercase. And are you guys putting my email, or not my email, my mailing address on there?
No.
Okay.
No.
My mailing address is P.O. Box 33 in Guymon, Oklahoma. 73942 is the zip code.
Okay. Very good.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate it.
Thank you. With us now, Lana Haynes. Lana, tell us a little bit about yourself. Where are you from?
I'm from Keys, Oklahoma, USA.
So far away.
Yes.
All right. How long have you been going to Panhandle?
This is my fifth year at OPSU.
And why did you choose Panhandle?
Well, it's nearby, but actually, I had been taking oil painting for about 10 years over from a lady at Guymon, and I absolutely adored her. But I felt like I needed to grow in my work and my understanding of art.
Mm-hmm.
And so I decided to enroll. And luckily I had a few hours from 1971 that I could use on my transcript. So I'm finishing up in 5 years. Yeah.
No, that's good.
So,
that's good, though.
Yeah.
Welcome back.
Thank you. Yes.
All right. So has art always been in your life, or is this something that you just, I mean, if you've been painting for 10 years, well, 10 plus 5, so,
no, it hasn't always been in my life.
Is it just one day you're like, yeah, I think I want to paint?
Yes, yeah. I thought I needed to do something else other than work, and so I decided to try painting and really
painting?
Fell in love with it.
Why is that? Why? What is it about that? What is it about that release, that artistic release that you thought, oh, painting, why not crocheting afghans?
Well, yeah, I understand that. I don't really know. I guess it was in the back of my mind that I could do it, maybe. Maybe, and it's just a joy to me to paint. It's just a joy.
I like to hear that. All right, so you've got three pieces
yes,
in here
I do.
Today.
Yes.
Let's start with this one, because this one, I don't know if the camera can see the depth on this.
Yeah, this piece is very textural. It's acrylic and modeling paste, and it was an assignment to do a lot of texture in a piece, and so this is what I went with, and I guess my instructors ended up liking it because it got in the Paul Farrell auction. So they I guess they liked it.
Explain the details. Explain how you get all of these different.
Okay, this is tissue paper with acrylic on top of it. This is actually eggshell embedded in modeling paste. This is layers and layers of acrylic.
Okay.
And you just build up layer by layer till you get the texture that you want.
Okay.
And it gives it a 3D effect, more or less, for still being a 2D work.
Right.
It gives it a 3D effect.
So how did you pick the subject?
Just thought that waves have a lot of action to them, and thought I could show the texture of the wave in this piece.
I like the colors.
Thank you.
I really like the colors that you've selected. Very nice.
If you think about sunlight going through waves, there's a lot more colors than just blue and green. It's a lot more colors.
There really is. All right, tell us about this piece.
This is called City Brights, and I wanted to show a lot of light after a rainfall. So this is the reflection of the lights in a sort of a wet street. So wanted a lot of color in this piece, and a lot of reflection, a lot of light.
All right, so whenever you're doing a piece like this, the perspective, just how do you get that perspective just right? Because it's not real easy whenever some people think, oh, I'm going to draw a street, we think straight across.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, the diagonal street gives it a lot more interest, and you learn about vanishing points in school. And there's your vanishing point over there, and everything leads towards the vanishing point. So it's pretty simple, but you don't want to forget it when you're doing a piece like this, or it'll get thrown out really quick. Maybe even thrown out the window. You know,
I really like the colors. I think it's very good.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. Tell
this
us about
just
this one.
A flower field in full bloom. Kind of a simple subject, maybe done a lot, but apparently my instructors liked it because they accepted it into the auction. And
very nice. So this one, is this a photograph that you've taken?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So what other mediums do you work in?
Oh, every medium. When you're in school, you have to do every medium. Oil, acrylic. These are all acrylics. Acrylic dries fast, and you can move right along in your piece.
Which one's your favorite?
Acrylic is definitely my favorite. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
What is it about it?
It dries fast, and you're not messing it up by getting your hand. Oil takes forever to dry. Actually, one of my instructors said he had done a piece in college that he thought was still wet. So oil, you're going to get back into it with your hand and mess it up. I mean, it's a favorite for portrait painters because of the blending. They can get a lot of shading and shadow in faces and such. But acrylics, I love acrylic. Yeah.
Okay. So what are you wanting to do after you graduate?
Not much. No, I really just wanted to improve my artwork. And I hope to sell pieces.
Okay, do you have pieces that you've sold yet?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
Very good. Have you been in any shows yet?
Not personal shows, just with the college. Yeah.
Okay, very good. Do you do commission work? Out of curiosity.
I have done commission work.
All right, so for our viewers, because again, they don't all get to come to this event, especially if it sold out in 24 hours.
Yes, it sold out very quickly this year.
It really did. So how do they get in touch with you so that way they can go ahead and get a piece commissioned?
Okay. They can contact Lana Haynes and, probably just my phone, 580-519-1211. But here's my card. And I would do commission work, yeah.
Okay, very good. All right, well, good luck in the auction this evening.
Thank you very much.
Come close. have with us now Ricky Baker.
Yes, ma'am.
All right, Ricky, where are you from?
I am from Durango, Colorado. It's in the southwest corner of Colorado, near the Four Corners.
Okay. Why did you choose Panhandle?
I originally came down here for the rodeo team, and I'm still pretty involved with the rodeo team, but I found myself in the art department more often, and so I just kind of stuck with it, and it's drawn me here, so.
So have your priorities changed?
Oh, no, I just added a major. I just added some priorities.
My life is not busy enough.
I know. I just had to add a few more years onto my education. I'm actually majoring in animal science with an emphasis in equine. And then I just added art as a major with an emphasis in pastel as well as drawing.
Uh-huh.
And I hope to get a minor in psychology as well.
Okay, so what are you planning on doing with all of this? This is like a shotgun effect for a job in the future. I'm going to get a job.
No. I would like to work in breeding and genetics with an equine program somewhere. Horses have always been a part of my life, and I hope they continue to be.
Uh-huh.
After I hopefully have enough money saved up, I would like to start a therapeutic riding center for veterans.
Okay.
And so include my equine and my psychology and my art all in one thing, one package.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Sounds like a good plan. All right, so... you've added art as a major. Why did you add this as a major rather than just going, I think I'm going to draw or I'm going to paint?
Well, even when I was younger, I've always had pencils or crayons in my hand ever since I can remember. And my grandma and my mom and my dad have been the biggest pushes for my art. And so whenever I started hanging out with Dustin Martinez, he started bringing me up to the art department a lot, and I just started getting really involved with them. And I started like, well, you know, maybe I should take a little class or two, and I'm actually just taking a full course now. So.
Okay, so you've always had art in your life,
yes.
One way or another. So, did you feel as though this is something? Whenever you decided I'm going to take a class, did you take the class with a lot of confidence? I am going to be really good at this. I know I will.
Well, I'm a really fast learner. And the last art class I ever took, I was in sixth grade. So
oh, wow.
I was like, well, you know, you're going to be behind a little bit compared to some of these other kids. But as long as you push yourself, you stay determined, you stay persistent, you'll catch them. And I just keep working hard every day.
Wow.
I go in and try really hard, and I'm getting some products.
Judging by this piece, I think you are a very fast learner, because this is a very nice piece. Go ahead and tell us about this.
I tried to bring a little piece of my home to everybody here in the Panhandle. You don't really see very many bears around here, but bears are an average, you know, part of daily life where I'm from. And I also went with some arbitrary colors, some different blues, and part of a black bear maybe.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to bring some cool colors like our mountains and our fresh waters, you know, somewhere where we don't have a whole lot of those. And I just wanted to
Not
bring
a
little piece of my home down here. And I thought this was a good piece to do it with.
So is this a photograph that you have done, or is this something that you just, where did you get your inspiration?
Well, I wanted to do a couple bears on a river, and I was like, you know, sounds pretty hard. So I started looking at some pictures, you know, different poses of some bears, and I was like, you know, I really like that pose. And, you know, he's just looking off into the distance, and you can tell that he's kind of getting turned a little bit, turned around. He's at an angle and a perspective, and I was like, that catches my eye. And I was like, well, how am I going to do this? How am I going to make it my own? How am I going to bring my home into this piece? Because, you know, you can find a black bear anywhere over there, but how is it going to be my home? And in the middle of the Rockies, it's blue everywhere. Fresh water, cool mountains, blue sky. You can't beat blue, so.
So it's very good.
Blue.
So what was the most challenging piece of this?
His eyes are at a very awkward angle. They're at different angles, actually. So being able to master the different angle as well as getting the same perspective and same direction as they're looking,
mm-hmm.
it challenged me. But, you know, I had Yvonne Sangster there to help me every step of the way. You know, every question, how do I fix this? Maybe add a little light here. Maybe add a little more dark here. Push your darks. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what's the most challenging part of the class that you're taking?
Classes.
Let's just focus on the art classes that you're taking right now. What is the most challenging part, and what is the most rewarding part?
the most rewarding part is seeing your pieces come to life, like from just an idea to a reality. That's the best part of it. The hardest part of it is getting it to look exactly the way you want it in your mind, because you can't, you know, your teacher and stuff can't crawl into your mind and see what you're trying to see, so they can only help you so far. And so, you know, Miss Yvonne, she's always told us, if I can teach you to see, I'm doing my job. And so I threw this piece, I really tried to see what I couldn't see in the black bear, you know, different highlights, you know, my different tones. I really, really tried to put a lot of effort into this piece.
So what other mediums do you like to work with?
I love drawing, just graphite pencil.
Just graphite?
Yeah, I love it. I don't really know what it is. It's just what I always did when I was younger. So it's always stuck with me. And now that I'm in school, I'm perfecting. I'm perfecting what I've already practiced for my whole life. And I actually just finished a piece called Dusty's Luck. It's a bowl for my boyfriend, Dustin. Go figure. But I can't wait to produce some more pieces. I was really, really happy with the way it turned out.
Yeah. All right, so is pastel, is it kind of similar in the strokes and the movements that you're using with graphite, or are they way completely different?
They're completely different. You use, you know, your pencils, your different softs and hards in your pencils. Pastel, it's a pigment. It's not like chalk, but that's the easiest way to explain it to somebody who wouldn't know.
Right.
It's just like small fragments of chalk in a sense, but it's pure pigment. So it'll stick and the color will stay for as long as it's not touched. And you don't spray anything over it because it'll dull the color. That's why we do a double mat so the glass stays off of it.
Okay.
So the dust doesn't come off.
Very good. All right. Well, good luck. Oh, wait. So the frame.
Yes, I built the frame as well.
Tell me about the frame.
So I had some help with this. My professor, one of my professors, Nels Peterson, he has a wood shop in his backyard. So I was
Surprise.
Like, you know, go figure. So I figured, why not ask him to help you build something? So I asked him, will you help me build a frame? And he's like, sure, why not? So we ordered some Irish pine, and I stained it red sienna. And I did, I cut this out using a drill or a bit, and I painted it blue and put a torch on it and glued it back in, and it just brought my whole piece together. It brought a lot of unity to it.
Yeah, it's very nice. Very nice.
Thank you.
All right, well, good luck in the auction
Thank
tonight.
You very much.
If our viewers, if they would like to commission a piece, do you do this?
Oh,
would
yes.
Would you be interested in it?
I would be interested.
All right. Give them your contact information.
Okay. You guys can reach me at my email, rickybaker, R-I-C-K-I-E, at yahoo.com, or you can contact me through my text message or phone call even. You can leave me a voicemail at 970-403-6190.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Farrell, Paul's widow. So tell us a little bit. I know every year we come out here and we have the instructors. Usually it's been Brian Test or Brent Shoulders. We've had different people tell us the history of the event. But I think it's a little bit better if you can give us the history. Yes, tell us about your late husband.
This is our 17th auction. We started out one time that we would do one, and we've been too successful. We keep doing better all the time. We have had so many successes that it really does make me humble. My husband was an amateur artist, and he spent all of his time when he wasn't working doing artwork, and he got a cancer in his eye as he got older and lost his eye. Well, then he came over here to the college to get help for that disability, and fell in love with what they were doing here and what he could do. And he went to school here then until he passed away. Well, Brian Tess came to me after that and said the kids were just devastated because they had never lost anybody that close before. And could we do one auction, just one? Well, number 17. And this is how we have done. Paul never, ever got tired of his artwork, many. This is my son, Gary Farrell.
First of all, I'd like to thank Oklahoma Panhandle State for continuing this, and I would like to thank Steve Long for donating the building. As far as the art, it's extremely impressive, and I am impressed with the quality of work, so thank you again.
Well, Paul was a very, very gentle man. I mean, he was so talented, and yet you would never know. I mean, he would never speak about his talent. He was just one of those kind of people that he was just a common, down-to-earth person. He was the sweetest man you could ever meet, but yet he was this very special, special guy, and very talented. I mean, he made all the Christmas ornaments for my tree, and just absolutely gorgeous. I still have those ornaments today. He was like a second father to me, and I'll never forget him. I'll never forget Paul as long as I live.
You don't have a clean house if you have an artist.
Oh, I can imagine.
Because they want every empty space to be something to put their work in. He took a lot of water cover, and that stuff had to dry. I thought his best was pastels, didn't you, Gary? He did an awful lot of artwork, but he never charged for it. It was just a hobby. And he did a lot of things for people that needed artwork, but he loved it. That was something he enjoyed doing. And he did over 2,000 paintings. One carousel horse, 9 dollhouses, and a lot of our vases and our lamps. Yes, and he tooled in leather. It was just a hobby for him, so he didn't have to worry about pleasing somebody or getting paid for it.
Well, how long was he a student at Panhandle State?
He went to school over here about 2.5 years. The doctors took his eye out in February of 98, and he passed away in June of 2000. So he went during that time, and he learned so much, different techniques and things that he wouldn't have known how to do. One was to paint on tissue paper, and he made a beautiful painting. Another time they did some kind of a painting where they had to spray it with some kind of a sealer and made it look like it was glass. So yeah, he had a great time. He really did. And he loved the kids, and the kids, well, he was older than most of his parents, but he enjoyed it. It was really a pleasure. I'm sorry it didn't last longer than it did. And then we started the art auction to help. Well, you can see what we've done now.
Is there anything that you would like our viewers to know about your husband's legacy?
People ask me all the time, what would he have thought about all this? He never would have dreamed of it, would he? And it's a bittersweet thing for me because I remember why we do it, but then when I think of all the good we've done, he worked for Phillips. He was area manager here, and when he would travel sometime, he'd take his artwork with him, and he'd say the women that cleaned the rooms and say, that's mine when you leave, I get to keep that. A little school kid one time had to do some kind of an art project, and his parents sent him to Paul. Paul made that child a copy of the... It was the crookedest street in the United States in San Francisco. He made that into a sculpture. Oh, I wanted that so bad. Some of the best things that he ever got to do was somebody else suggested it, wanted him to do it for them. Like Grandma Farrell wanted him to do those family crests. And he fell in, he loved that, yeah. So it was something that he enjoyed, he looked forward to, he never got tired of. Poor guy, one of the teachers wanted a teddy bear. And I think he probably did, 10 teddy bears? And people went about, kept saying, well, it was the Tim bear from Dick and Jane. And everybody wanted one. And he finally got so tired doing teddy bears, but he did them in pastels. He won a lot of shows. We entered them in contest, and he won every one. Walk away with grand prize every time. So, and he won, after he started over here at school, I forgot what it was called, something about the artist, college artist. He won first place in that. And he got painting of the year. He did, but we never did it for anything except just for his enjoyment, for his pleasure.
So did he take painting classes through the years or just?
Well, he never could figure out how to watercolor. So he took some classes on watercolor. Other than that, he was just painting for his pleasure. He'd come take classes, but it was for, because he wanted just for his entertainment, his pleasure. Yeah. But isn't this amazing night, what they do, all this stuff in these kids? It is incredible.
Yeah, so
we're real proud of them.
I was gonna say, so from the first auction until this auction,
we had nothing for that first one. We borrowed all those easels and had to work on them. And some of the ladies in town made some candy for us. And we had the activity center of a church, and we had to get out the same day. And now look what we've done. All this equipment stuff, they've been able to buy it and purchase it, and the kids get the money half of what they sell their artwork for.
Right.
It's been an amazing experience. And Sean was right here from the very start. But yeah,
he was.
Yeah, he was. I think he was one of the first ones, weren't you? I'm going to tell you age.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I really appreciate you telling us a little bit about him.
Well, it's
been an
experience. It has. One that I never dreamed. I never thought it would ever go class number one. That's always hoping for us, have a crowd for number one. That first night, we thought nobody would come, and they just kept coming. The people just kept coming.
Well, it's turned into quite an event.
It was quite an evening. And then number two, and here we are. Yeah. And I think we have done a lot of good. I have seen a lot of good that we've done. We've helped kids do things that would help them have a better college experience. And that's pretty important. We lose too many kids. And if you can kind of give them a helping hand, you've done something good.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
It's been good meeting you. Yeah. Bye-bye.
All right, that about wraps it up for this episode of Inside OPSU. I have had a great time talking with the student artist, as well as Marjorie Farrell. It was very entertaining this evening. For Inside OPSU and PTCI Channel 2, I'm Consuelo, and I'll see you on campus.